everybody. Thanks for joining with us today. God has made us all in His image, and His kingdom should be a place of refuge for us all. And this week, we're gonna focus in on how we can help one another, how we can help see each other's pain, how we can help be agents in His kingdom for justice. Let's take a minute to pray and ask God to reveal to us how we can join Him in what He is doing in this kingdom. Lord, help us. Help us see the pain that no one else sees. Help us hear the cries that no one else is hearing. God, activate and awaken our hearts in a way that will produce hope in our broken world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The difficulties of life, Jesus gives us hope. And this hope that Jesus gives us is one that I truly believe will transform us all if we let it seep down into our hearts and transform the way that we think. This week, we are starting a new series. Our whole church is looking through the book of Ephesians. Now, Paul, the writer of Ephesians, wrote to the church in Ephesus, and he gave them wisdom and instruction in a few areas to help them grow and help them be all that God had created them to be. I'm going to read a rather lengthy segment of that, but it'll begin our process of talking because I believe what Paul was saying to them at that time also applies to us here and now at this time. Ephesians 1 verse 3, how blessed is God and what a blessing he is. He is the Father of our Master, Jesus Christ, and takes us to the high places of blessing in him. Verse 4, long before he laid down earth's foundations, he had us in mind, had settled on us as the focus of his love, to be made whole and holy by his love. Verse 5, long, long ago, he decided to adopt us into his family through Jesus Christ. What a pleasure he took in planning this. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of his lavish gift-giving by the hand of his beloved Son. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, his blood poured out on the altar of Christ, we are a free people, free of penalties and punishments chalked up by our misdeeds. And not just barely free either, abundantly free. He thought of everything and he provided for everything we could possibly need, letting us in on the plans he took such a delight in making. He set it out all before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything would be brought together and summed up in him. Everything in the deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. We are free. We are free to bring hope. We are free to bring the good news, this gospel message of Jesus transforming everything. We are free to tell one another that though we were destined for death, we can have life in Jesus. And thanks be to God, the story does not end in death, but it ends in hope. It ends in restoration. Our calling is to be that relationship, to extend Jesus, to bring hope to those who need it. Our high school group is called Refuge because refuge is a place that people can go to find shelter, to find hope. And all throughout the Bible, specifically the Old Testament, God is this place of refuge where people can go to who need him, who need hope, who need love. And when you accept Jesus into your heart, when you choose to live as a follower of Christ, you then are an image bearer of God, an image bearer called to be a place of refuge. In the book of Genesis, when God creates Adam and Eve, man and woman, he said, I am going to make them in the image of God. They were created. We are made in the image of God. And in God's image, we have a value because of what God does in us. Not because of what we can do, but our value comes in whose we are, and that is Jesus's. And when we take our value that he has given us and remind other people of the hope that they can have, that they were born to be sons and daughters of the King. So many people have forgotten that truth. And especially in our culture and our world today, there is so much fighting against that. There is so much that people have forgotten that we are image bearers of the King, that we have value, that our lives matter. And you who have Jesus, you who found hope, are called to extend that hope, to fight for it, to fight for the justice that needs to happen in our world, because God so loves you as much as he loves me, as much as he loves the people around us. And that brings us to the main idea of how do we bring refuge to our world that is broken, that is fighting, that is filled with confusion. We bring refuge by seeing one another, not as another, not as the other person, not as the one over there. We bring refuge to our world by seeing each other as we. Another way of saying it is moving from me to we. When we see someone else as the other, it's easy to villainize them, to attack them. Did you see what they did today? Did you see why did they do that? As soon as you see someone else as other than or not part of your group, it's easy to attack them, isn't it? But when you see someone as we, when they're your friend, your best bud, man, we will fight for them. I remember I was playing in rugby. It was one of my first days of practice with the team. And there was a guy named Boris. And Boris decided that he was going to help show me the ropes. And I remember while I was building relationships with the team, I was closest with Boris. And whenever Boris got in trouble, I knew I was going to be there. Because I went from seeing him as another to a we. And the more that I played on this team, the more that I realized this we concept, that we fight for one another, we battle with one another, because that is what we do when we care. couple weeks ago, SpaceX, led by Elon Musk, took two people to the International Space Station. Now, those two astronauts, they didn't get there by themselves. They didn't build a rocket and fly to the International Space Station just because they thought it was cool. There is a whole team of people actively working toward that goal in mind. When we work together, when we pull the gifts that God has given us, what we are able to do is far beyond what you or I could do alone. And that is the beauty of what God has created for us. That when we do this life together, we call that the church, when we come together under Jesus and follow him and bring hope to those around, there is so much power that comes from that. But there are so many out there who need that power, who need that transformation, who need that touch. And that is why we fight. Not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, because there is an enemy out there trying to destroy your brother, your sister. And so we come and we fight for that, not with guns, not with guns and clubs, but we fight with prayer. We fight recognizing that the enemy is trying to destroy God's image bearers. And we have an opportunity to bring hope to those who are hopeless. When we see each other as we are empowered to go and both emotionally and empathetically stand up against injustices, to stand up against people who are being hurt. Here's an example of this. There's a pastor from Hillsong Church on the East Coast. He explained why this idea of Black Lives Matter is important. And he explains it in a way that's a little in your face, but it makes sense.
I said a statement last week, which was a very mild statement, because I believe we want to agree with God. We want to be on God's side. My statement was this: for me, I believe that Black lives matter. That's what I said. Anybody with a functioning brain understands that all lives matter. Anybody. But right now, there is a portion of our community that is frustrated and they are suffering and they are hurting. So as an empathetic Christian, I'm going to go and say, I agree with the statement, Black lives do matter. But I was glad some people disagreed with me because I kept saying, do Black lives matter? Yes or no? Yes, but. I'm like, there is no but. We disagree. Those are the same type of people that would have interrupted Jesus during the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus would have been like, blessed are the poor. No, Jesus, blessed are all people. Since when does highlighting one issue disparage another? Are we not secure enough to be able to sit here and go issue by issue and just talk about one without disparaging another? Of course, all lives matter, but it's okay to say Black lives matter. What's wrong with you? This is now rocket science. All lives matter. No kidding. That's why we're saying Black lives matter, because until all lives matter equally, we need to focus on this.
The reason I wanted to show that clip is because there are lots of issues in this life, and there are things that God has called you and me to help bring hope to. And right now, our culture is looking at this one issue that is incredibly important, because everybody's life is on the line here. What God is trying to do to bring hope and to bring justice in the world, God cares about those. God cares about each of us. And we are called to stand in the gap. We are called to be brothers and sisters, to extend love. And we can do that by caring for multiple things at a time. Let's care for people. You know, there's another clip that I want you to see, because in acting as we, sometimes it gets confusing of how do I begin to see the world as we? How do we move forward? How do we do this together? Well, as we're made in God's image, and as we look to be part of the solution, there's another pastor, his name is Stephen Furtick. He was talking to a pastor named John Gray, and they discussed a little bit of how we can move forward together, not as individuals, separate in this world, but as brothers and sisters in Christ.
One of the things that I said this week was that I have never firsthand experienced the brutality of systemic and overt racism toward black men and women in America. And I thought, you know, well, maybe someone will criticize some of that. And somebody did. Somebody said, you use the word overt, but it's really the covert racism that we have to be more concerned about. Somebody said, you use the word systemic racism. You're just a pawn for the mainstream media, and you're just, you're just regurgitating terms. But what I didn't see coming, this is what I was telling you. It's not really funny, but it's funny, and it goes to show how, you know, we have to speak even though people may misunderstand. Somebody actually sent me a message, and what they took offense with was men and women who are black. And they crossed out men and women and said people, because by saying men and women, I was not being gender inclusive enough. So here I am, follow the whole thought, talking about a man who is suffocating on the street, screaming for his mother and the injustice of it. And somebody is correcting the typo of like it's a paper with a typo. And I realized that if we wait for everyone to agree with
that's
it,
right,
or figure out how to say it just right, like it might come out wrong, but at least we're speaking.
Come on.
And I may say something stupid, but we have lost this art of conversation because we have replaced it with clicks and comments. And so we don't talk, so we don't empathize. And since we have no relationships with people who don't understand our perspective, we continue to use even religious as a system to confirm our biases. Because we go to church with people who think just like us, look just like us, vote just like us, grew up just like us, sang songs, clapped on the two and the four, the one and the three, clapped just like us, moved just like us. And because we never challenge ourselves in our perspective, we stay stuck in states of spiritual immaturity and even regressive states where we can't stand with anyone because we've never stretched to understand anybody else's experience.
I think we need to just give God a 5-second praise break all over EFAM, Rock Family. Come on, let's just bless Jesus. Pastor Stephen, thank you. Thank you for saying what you're saying right now. Because this is not about, are we saying the perfect thing? Allow us to have an emotional human moment. When you read Psalm 137, the writer says, how can we sing in a strange land? Then at the end of the psalm, he says, Lord, dash my enemies' children against the rocks. What a horrible thing to write. Why is it in the Bible? Because God allowed for the human emotion to be expressed without judgment. We don't want the truth. We want to feel good. And I want to say this. This conversation is not the end, it's a beginning. And what I also want to say is that if we only separate this by race, we're going to lose the necessary people that need to be involved in the conversation. Every white person is not a racist. This should not be a place where white people need to apologize for being white. I'm sorry for what my ancestors did. That's great, but it wasn't you. Being a part of a system doesn't mean that you overtly are committing horrific acts. I think each individual should be dealt with based on their character and what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And so white people should not be sitting around feeling guilty because they're white. And people who say things like this really scare me. God doesn't see color. I've never seen color. I'm colorblind. Well, then you got a problem because God is not colorblind or culture blind. He created color and culture because he wanted diversity, which is in John 17. Father, make them one as you and I are one, which means diversity was the seed to see if we would lay down our culture and pick up the kingdom. And that's why this conversation is important.
Right.
All white people aren't bad anymore than all black people are good and altruistic. You've got individuals that are broken in every race, in every culture and subsection. But this is a necessary conversation, and it should not be approached from a judgmental perspective. Mm-hmm. And I don't want people feeling like they are already being judged as wrong or judged as unworthy of change because of the pain of the moment. On the other side, mm-hmm. I shouldn't have to temper my emotions to quell to your discomfort. I'm enraged. I'm also scared because it could be me. It's enough that there's a virus that's killing people that look like me at a disproportionate rate. I got a virus that I gotta fight, and there's a virus called racism that I've been fighting. So the pressure of both is a lot. And I think that we need to be able to be okay with the conversation without shredding each other's humanity.
Yeah.
We're not monolithic. All African Americans don't think the same. All white people don't think the same. You know, I went to the White House, and brother, black people were finished with me. It's like, oh no, he didn't. I know he wasn't up there with him, because black people have been in so much pain that what they saw was someone who identifies with who has now become, to many of them, the picture of systemic oppression. They saw an image but didn't see the substance. When I went to the White House, I went because I wanted to talk about prison reform. I don't work for that administration. I've not received anything, but I needed to sit at the table. I thought it was important, and it turns out that legislation that I went to speak about was one of the few bipartisan pieces of legislation that helped black and brown people to get out of the prison industrial complex. But people didn't see that, and I understand why. Because when you're in pain, the first thing I see is the thing I remember the most. Yeah. And so I have to understand that even though my heart was pure, so was their pain. And so I have to understand that we're at a very sensitive place.
We are on this journey of life together. Let us bring hope. Let us bring hope to one another, being part of the wave that God is moving to bring restoration, to care for one another. You know, I'm reminded of this song, the song that talks about Jesus leaving the 99 to go after the one, because he cares for the one. Now, in context, those 99 are taken care of because how shepherds would take care of their sheep is they'd kind of pull their sheep together, and there'd be multiple of them taking care of the whole herd of flock, and at the end of the day, they'd all go their own ways to put their sheep back in their individual pens. But if one sheep from my flock got lost, well, my friends would help take care of the other 99 while I went off to find them. And Jesus paints this picture as how beautiful it is that God is coming after us, like the one to find us. Now, sometimes it's really easy to think, oh, well, I'm one of the 99, like I'm chilling. Jesus is going out finding someone else. No. We are the one. Each of us at one point or another, some of you even now, are the one that is lost. And Jesus is saying, I am coming for you because I love you, because you matter, because you are my image bearer. He loves us. And if you are one who recognizes how much he loves us, I encourage you to pray for those who need to be found, remembering that you too were once lost, or remembering that you are lost and you're trying to figure things out. And if that's in the place that you're in, know that we're praying for you, because Jesus died so that you would be free from death, as it talks about here in Ephesians, and have eternal life with him. Over the next few minutes, we're going to sing this song, Reckless Love, that talks about Jesus' reckless love, where he was willing to abandon heaven, where he was willing to die so that you and I could be restored, so that we could all be restored in the kingdom. We matter because he loves us. As this song plays, you might need to be reminded of God's reckless love for you. In which case, embrace the message of hope that is here for you now. Or you might need to stand in the gap and pray for someone who does not know God's reckless love. You might need to pray for people in our culture who need to understand Jesus' love and the transforming power. In this song, take a minute to reflect and worship the King of Kings, whom you are his image bearer, and who loves you more than you can possibly imagine.
shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No, there's no shadow.
Thanks for joining us this week as we continue to go day by day, learning how we can be agents of justice in this world. I encourage you to pray, to learn, and to continue to seek forth what God would have you do in such a time as this to bring hope to those who need to know about Jesus' love. See you next week.